Well, welcome back today on this last Sabbath of 2001 as we continue studying the Christian basics. Again, let's number the steps to Christ that we've already looked at. The first step is to know and recognize and appreciate the love of God. God's love is the basis for everything that exists. There would be nothing without God's love. It's His love that created the cosmos. And this love of God is the foundation stone of every individual Christian experience. It's when we recognize God's love that good things start to happen in our lives. This picture. Ordinary human nature is selfish. It's in rebellion against God. It's unable to conform to His law. If Christianity is to take hold of our lives, we need to recognize that we are sinners and in need of a Savior. And that's step two. And the next step is repentance. Repentance does not mean to feel sorry for your past sins. Formation of mind. We need to be reoriented, to be pointed in the opposite direction. We need change, deep, fundamental, basic change in our minds, in our hearts, in our lives. A change not just in our behavior, but a change in us. And so the fourth step is to confess our sins. First and foremost, we confess them to God. Confess and forsake them. Give them up to Him. Ask Him to take them away. And then there's some things that we need to make right. The people. Relationships with others. Maybe relationships that need to be restored. There may be things that we have done in the past. We need to apologize for and confess and make right. If so, that needs to be done if we're going to make progress as Christians. And the fifth step is consecration. To be consecrated. That means given to God. The whole life and everything in it. This is really a Christian basic. And lots of people don't recognize it. They want God just to change some little behavioral things about them. But they don't see that their whole person needs to be changed. And they don't understand that all of themselves needs to belong to God. God can't change a life that doesn't belong to Him. And we're not His unless we're His entirely. And so the sixth step is our topic for today. Faith and acceptance. You've come to believe in God's love. You've given your whole life to Him. You've given to Him anything that would separate you from Him. And now you need to take that life and fill it with positives. You need peace, a sense of heaven's forgiveness and peace. You need faith and trust in God. You need assurance that you are accepted by Him. Assurance. A sense of confidence. Certainty. Security. In your relationship with God. Money can't buy it. Human intelligence can't get it for you. You'll never get this by your own efforts. Or by any human means. Or human doings. But God gives it. Without money. And without price. When you've given your life to God, it's time for some faith and assurance. Under the gospel, you're entitled to these things. It's time to put away feelings of guilt, the insecurities, the neuroses, the anxieties. By the grace of God, you have a right to peace and security. There's no security in human support. You can't make yourself secure. Life is out of your control. And especially the future after you die is out of your control. There's no way you can make it certain. But if all your hopes are pinned on God, then there's security. It's time to feed on God's promises. There's a couple more of them that are going on the screen. Though your sins be as scarlet, I will make them white as snow. God promises to do this. Quit your worrying about your sins. When you gave them to God, God made them His responsibility. Of course, you keep on fighting against them. You don't just lie down next to them and go to sleep. Let them exist without ever thinking about them. You keep fighting against the sins in your life, but you don't focus on it. You don't worry about it. If you focus on the sins in your life, you'll never defeat them. What's got your attention has got you. What God wants you to do is to give those sins to Him, trust Him to take care of them, to take them out of your life. Let Him have them. Say, God, I'm tired of this thing. I've fought it for years. I lose all the time. You've got to take this away. I can't control it. It takes your power to overcome this thing, and I know you're going to do it. And you keep on fighting against it. You don't put any confidence in your fighting. You know that your fighting isn't going to win the war. And those deep scarlet, God will wash them away. Jesus bore those sins on the cross, and they're done for, paid for, taken away. Jesus defeated those sins already. He doesn't have to win the war against them now. He's already won it. The war against your sins is already won. And if you give them to Jesus, He'll mop them up, clean them out. And day by day, your life will come to look more and more like His. That will melt away, one piece at a time. Here's another promise. A new heart will I give you, and a new spirit I will put within you. All of these things are in your sermon notes. You might want to take your sermon notes out and follow along with it. A new heart I will give you. A new spirit I will put within you. You need it to be new. And God needs to do this for you. You can't do it. Fixing yourself, fixing your heart, getting yourself a new spirit, trying to do that on your own is like trying to grab your shoelaces and pull yourself up off the ground into the air. It doesn't work. It doesn't happen. The Bible asks you if you can bring a clean drink out of a dirty cup. Of course you can't. I remember playing football at the beach one day with my contacts in my eyes and getting plowed into the sand nose first. And there was no way I could get the sand out of my eyes because my hands were sandy. And if I tried to brush them off on my pants and my sweatshirt, they're sandy too. You can't fix your own problem. You can't clean yourself up with dirty hands. It takes an outside solution. And God's the cure. He can do it. His hands are clean. And He has the power. And maybe even more important, He wants to do it. And the point here is, you need to trust His ability to fix this. You need to trust not only His ability, but His will, His desire to do it. He wants to do it. He loves you. He cares about you. He wants to clean you up. He is able to clean you up. And if you give your life to Him, there's nothing that's going to stop Him from cleaning you up. Because there's nothing in the universe big enough to stop God when He decides to do something. Trust Him. It's going to happen. It's guaranteed. It's certain. The Psalms say the promises of God are sure. And that includes the promise on the screen. And you need to believe this. If it's going to happen in your life, you need to believe it. Believing these promises, trusting them, gives God something to work with in your life. So He can start to make the changes that need to be made. He needs to have your faith and your trust and your belief in His promises. Faith is the word. Faith, trust, belief in God's promises. And that's the next step to Christ. Faith is the victory that overcomes the world. The world outside, the world inside. Faith is the victory that overcomes the world. And faith brings all other blessings in its train. When you trust God, when you believe that your sins are forgiven, when you believe that He will conquer those sins in your life, then the love and joy and peace that are the fruit of the Holy Spirit begin to flow through your life. You feel set free, emancipated. Everything begins to look brighter. God's your friend. He walks with you and talks with you and lives in your heart. And the bad stuff begins to look not so attractive anymore. God will use your faith to build good stuff into your life. And He will use your faith to conquer the bad stuff in it. Faith is the victory that overcomes the world. And it overcomes your fears and anxieties, your depression and loneliness, your worries and insecurities. You're rock solid because you trust in God. You don't know what the future holds, but you know who holds the future. And He's holding your life too. And it's not in danger anymore. You don't need to worry if your sins are forgiven. You don't need to worry if you've forgotten to confess some little sin somewhere. You don't need to worry if you're sorry enough for the bad stuff you've done. You've given your life to God, and He's responsible for it. Now, it's safe. Faith in this fact sets you free. It turns you loose. When you've put your life in God's hands, and you trust those hands, it sets you free. Faith is liberating. And it doesn't just set you free, it sets you free to grow. Free to become more and more what God wants you to be. You'll never have this growth that you need while you're carrying around a load of doubt and insecurity. That sandbags you, it weighs you down. It makes progress impossible. You need to know that God has forgiven you. You need to know that He has accepted you. You need to know that you're all right with Him in order to grow and develop as a Christian. And God tries. He tries so hard to assure you of this, to make it clear, to tell you how much He loves you, to tell you that He has accepted you, to guarantee you forgiveness of your sins when you come to Him with your life in your hands and say, "Here it is, God. It's yours." When you give Him all of those struggles and problems that you've had, say, "God, these are yours. I don't want them. Take them away. You deal with them. Take them out of my life. I want these things gone. They belong to you. I give them to you." When you do this, you need to have the faith and the assurance that God is as good as His promises. You need to know that He has forgiven you, that He's accepted you, that you're all right with Him in order to grow and to have this. They think that what they need to do is to pray real hard and whip up some big lump of faith in order to be forgiven and healed. But that's not what Jesus says. He says, if you have faith as a grain of mustard seed, it'll do the job. I think I've seen a mustard seed once. I don't know how big it is, but I understand it's just some tiny little seed. Doesn't take a lot of faith. It just takes faith. Because actually, what Jesus is saying in this parable is that it's not a quantity problem at all. It's just a yes or no question. Do you have believe God? Do you trust Him? It's not really a question of how much. It's an either or. Do you or don't you believe God? Do you or don't you trust Him? Jesus illustrated this in His miracles. John tells us the story of Jesus and the man sick laying beside the pool of Bethesda. The man was paralyzed. He couldn't walk. His legs were useless. Jesus passed by that day and saw him lying there and looked him in the eye and said, "Rise, take up your bed, walk." Now the sick man might have said, "Well, Lord, if you'll heal me, I'll get up and walk." But he didn't. Fortunately for him, he didn't. He didn't wait to feel healed. He didn't wait to feel that strength flowing through his legs. He just started to get up. He stood up in surprise. His legs held him. And he took some steps, and then he jumped in the air. He had believed Jesus' promise, and he had acted on it. It was never a question of how much faith he had. It was simply the question, do you believe Jesus or not? He did. He stood. And his legs were strong again after 38 years of lying on the ground. Another example of this is from the story of the Exodus. Children of Israel had wandered for 40 years in the wilderness. Moses had just died, and Joshua was now in charge. And they were about to enter the land of Canaan. They had come up into the land from the east, and they were needed to cross the Jordan River. And it was spring, and the river was running high and fast, and the fords were all too deep. But God told them to cross. He told them that he would hold back the river and allow them to cross on dry land. And he told Joshua that the priests carrying the ark were to go first. So on the day to cross the river, Joshua lined up the children of Israel, thousands and thousands and thousands, in a line extending way back and over the horizon. But the river was still running. The priests went to the ark. They covered it with its covering. They slid the rods through the rings. There were rings on the corners. They slid the rods through the rings. They picked it up, put it on their shoulders. Joshua ordered the priests to the head of the line. They took their place at the head of the line, but the river was still running. Joshua ordered them forward. They started to move. The priests had long practiced this. They carried the ark with very, very steady, slow, regular steps. Down, down, down toward the river. Down the banks, onto the sand, toward the river. And it's still running, deep and wide. The people followed right behind them. The priests are on the sandy edge of the water, and the river continues to run. The priests don't stop. Slowly, one measured step at a time, without pause or hesitation, they head on in. The two priests in front step into the water, and the river stopped. It began to pile up upstream, and downstream it ran on. The riverbed began to open up before the priests, and they never stopped moving forward. The lesson has been taught many times. The question is not how much faith do you have, it's just a question of do you have it or not. Will you go forward? Will you step into the water? Will you take God at his word? And then you have to act on your belief. The river didn't stop until the priest's feet were in it. The paralyzed man's legs weren't healed until he started up off the ground. And in the context that we're talking about today, you need to act like you're forgiven. Act like you believe that God will change your life. Don't wait to feel that you're forgiven. Don't wait to feel that God has cleaned up your life. Just say, I believe it. It is so, not because I feel it, but because God has promised it. Listen to this promise from Mark 11. When you pray for what you need, believe that you'll have it, and you will. These are Jesus' words. Act like you believe it. Don't wait to feel that God has answered your prayer. Stand up on those paralyzed legs. Step into that river. Believe that he has done it, that he's answered your prayer. Believe that he's done it not because you feel it, but because he's promised. And then thank him for the answer right away. You ask for the blessing you need, you believe that he's given it, and you thank him for it immediately. Now, of course, there's always a condition to answered prayer. It's that we pray according to his will. But in the cases we're talking about today, that's not a question. We know that what we're asking for is according to his will. When you're praying for a new car, you don't know whether that's God's will or not. But when you're praying for a clean life, when you're praying to be his child, when you're praying to lead a good and holy life by his grace, when you're asking him to take some sin away, you know it's his will. And you know he's going to answer yes. It's safe to pray for that. You can believe the answer is yes, and you can thank him for it. Acceptance. Faith and acceptance. You need the confidence that God has accepted you now, today. There won't be growth in your life until you have this confidence. God wants you to know that he has accepted you. He wants you to trust that. It's time to have a look at 1 John. Pull your Bibles out. There's Bibles in the pew racks if you didn't bring them with you. 1 John. Not the Gospel of John. The first letter of John. Comes late in the New Testament. Comes after all the letters of Paul, comes after the big book of Hebrews, comes after the short little letters of James and Peter, and it comes before the big book of Revelation, 1 John. Be sure you have 1 John, not 2 or 3 John. after the letters of Paul in Hebrews, after the little letters of James and Peter, and before the book of Revelation. 1 John. Letter. The language is so simple. This, by the way, is the book that they start beginning Greek students on. 1 John. It's where you start reading Greek when you're learning New Testament Greek. And this is the disciple John writing. Jesus' youngest disciple. But when he writes this, he's an old man. Today I want to call your attention to one little word. The word know. K-N-O-W. That's know as in knowledge, not know as in negative. The word know on the screen there. To know something. This word occurs 34 times in this short little book. 34 times John uses the word know. There's actually two words for know in Greek. John uses them both. 34 times. I want to call your attention to a few of them. Let's see how John uses this word. All of these references, by the way, are in your sermon notes. Right now, close to the end of the book, is 1 John 5:19. Have a look at that. 1 John 5:19. It says simply, we know that we are of God. Knowledge, certainty. Do you wonder if you really belong to God? You don't need to wonder. You can know it. We know that we are of God. Turn back a chapter. Chapter 4. 1 John 4:13. 1 John 4:13. We know that we dwell in Him. Almost the same idea. We can know we are His. We can know that we dwell in Him. God wants you to have that assurance. Doesn't want you to say maybe. He wants you to know that you dwell in Him. Let's move backward further. In chapter 3. Actually the last verse of chapter 3. 3:24. Last verse of chapter 3, 1 John 3:24. We know that He abides in us. Are you sure of that? Are you sure that God abides in you? You can be. John wants you to be sure of that. We know He abides in us. Let's move back a little further. This gets even stronger. We're still in chapter 3, 10 verses earlier, verse 14. 1 John 3:14. The language gets a little stronger here. We know that we have passed from death to life. Did you know that you can know that? You can. You can know that you have passed from death to life. John says you should. You can know. Verse 13. Maybe the strongest verse of all. 1 John 5:13. This one's dynamite. 1 John 5:13. You may know that you have what? Eternal life. You may know that you have eternal life. You can know that. You don't have to worry to be unsure. You don't have to keep asking, I don't know whether I'm saved or not. John says that we may know that we have eternal life. You know it not based on anything in yourself, but because God has promised it to those who come to Him in faith with their life in their hands and give it to Him. If you've done that, this verse is for you. We may know that we have eternal life. Well, these six verses are in your sermon notes. Please go home and read them over and over again, because I know what happens. You can have this assurance today while you're sitting here, and next day it's going to be gone. You know, it takes a while to get these ideas deep down into your heart. You need to review them. Don't just think that one dose will do it forever. It doesn't. You need to read these verses again and again. Because you need this kind of faith, this kind of assurance. You need to know that you have eternal life. If you give your whole life to Him, if you believe these promises, then it's true. In the book Steps to Christ, when she's talking about exactly this topic that we're talking about today, Ellen White's talking about this topic, she assures us it is so if you believe it. It is so if you believe it. Let me read you some more from Ellen White. These references are in sermon notes too. I think it's on the back side of the page. Have you got it there? This is great stuff. Listen to these. I'll read them. You can follow along in your sermon notes. When we have an assurance that is bright and clear of our own salvation. Then we shall exhibit the cheerfulness and joyfulness which becomes every follower of Jesus Christ. Cheerfulness and joyfulness. Too many people have a religion without cheerfulness and joyfulness. And you know why? It's because they don't have this assurance. That's why. Because their religion's full of insecurity and doubt, and they never really know whether they've been forgiven and accepted. There's no victories in that kind of faith. There's just worry and fear, and there's no Christian growth. But when we have an assurance that is bright and clear of our own salvation, then we will exhibit the cheerfulness and joyfulness that becomes every follower of Jesus Christ. You have a right to that as a Christian. Assurance, confidence, security in your relationship with God. Well, the next little quote there. Does Satan tell you that you cannot enjoy salvation full and free? Believe him not. Let me tell you, he's going to try. He's going to try to tell you that it's not so sure. He's going to try and take that security away from you. Don't let it. Believe him not. It's this faith, this certainty, this knowledge, this assurance that sets us free, that brings the love and joy and peace that are the fruit of the Spirit. Jesus said to his disciples, "Rejoice that your names are written in heaven." That's something to rejoice about, all right. And until you get that happiness inside of you, the next steps to Christ won't happen. Christian growth depends on joy and freedom. And it is killed, totally stopped, prevented by fear, anxiety, and human effort. Jesus taught these things in many ways. One of the most important ways was through stories, through parables. One of the most important and famous of all is the story we call the prodigal son. Luke is the only one that tells this story, by the way. Can you find Luke? Luke 15, Matthew, Mark, Luke. Before the book of John. Luke 15. Remember, Luke was the one who wrote the book of Acts that we studied last quarter. And it's Luke's version of the Christmas story, by the way, that we read every Christmas. Luke 2. Luke chapter 2. And this is the parable of the prodigal son that only Luke tells. And he tells it in chapter 15, starting in verse 11. Luke 15, starting in verse 11. Read it along. I'm going to read it to you. I'm going to paraphrase it a little bit and maybe leave out a verse or two. But you can follow along with me. Here's the story. As Jesus told it. A certain man had two sons. And the younger said to his father, "Father, give me the portion of your goods that falls to me." And so he gave him his inheritance. And soon the younger son packed up and traveled to a far country. And there he wasted his money on riotous living. And when he had spent it all, a severe famine arose in the land. And he was in need. So he went and hired himself out to a citizen of that country who sent him into his fields to feed the hogs. And he would have been happy to eat the hogs' feed, but they wouldn't allow him. And one day he woke up and he said to himself, "How many of my father's farm workers have food? Enough for themselves and some to spare. And here I am starving to death. I will arise and go to my father and say to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you, and I'm not worthy to be called your son. Please take me on as a hired worker.'" And he got up and went home to his father. But when he was a long way off, his father saw him and was moved with compassion and ran to him and hugged him and kissed him. And the boy said, "Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you, and I'm not worthy to be called your son." But the father interrupted him and said to the servants, "Quick, get my best robe and put it on him. Put the family signet ring on his finger and shoes on his feet. Get a fat calf and prepare it. Let's eat and drink and be merry. For this son of mine was dead and he's alive again. He was lost and he is found." And they began to celebrate. That's it. The prodigal son is us. And God is the Father. Don't ever think that he doesn't want you home. Don't ever think he's slow to forgive you. He watches the robe for you every day. The robe and the signet ring and the crown and the celebration banquet are waiting for you to come home. Well, next Sabbath it will be 2002. And we'll be back to continue taking Steps to Christ. The title next Sabbath will be Steps to Christ 7, The Test of Discipleship. I'll see you then. We're going to sing I Lay My Sins on Jesus again. Remember I told you the words are on the back side of the grace notes insert in your bulletin. Following this, I'll have a short benediction as we do at the end of every